Hello, Minnesota. Welcome back to the Tony Hernandez Show. Today is Saturday, March 2nd. We have a great show today. I took a week off. I wasn't here last week. Jake Dusenberg was filling in for me. It's been a pretty big last couple of weeks. As you know, I started a new job. I'm starting at First Option Mortgage. And so 2 weeks ago, I spent the entire week in Atlanta, Georgia. I was there for training. That's where our headquarters are. And then that Friday, I got back and literally went straight to a men's retreat in Amory, Wisconsin, and just spent the weekend reflecting and thinking about life and where we're going to go from here. And as many of you know who are Facebook friends with me, you know that Leona and I, we are expecting our first baby. We announced it to the world. We're 14 weeks into it and expecting our first one to arrive somewhere around September 1st. So we're really excited about that. And as a man, as a future father, it really has you reflect on one's life and what's important. And then also where I am specifically and where we want to be in the future. So yeah, it's big news. I'm excited. Equally excited about the guests that we have today. We have Donnell Tenner. He wrote a book called 240 Ways to Close the Achievement Gap. We have the mayor of Oak Grove, Mayor Mark Corbin. He's going to talk about some reforms that he's initiated into the city, and we're going to talk about some other issues as well. And then finally, towards the end of the hour, we're going to have Jake Dusenberg back on, and we're going to talk about the sequestration. We're going to talk about federal finances, and we're going to try to get into a little bit about real estate and where we see the real estate market heading from here. There's a lot of positive news in that. So without further ado, I'd like to bring on my first guest, Mr. Donnell Tenner, is here, and he's here to talk about our book. So, Donnell, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me, Tony.
I appreciate it. And so you wrote a book, and you want to just talk a little bit about what your book is exactly?
Well, basically, 240 Ways is a book that was kind of in me, and like your wife about to give birth to your first child. I'm giving birth to it. You know, it was supposed to come out last year, but I took it back, and I said, you know, there's some more I need to put into it. This book is a educational, conversational piece for any Tom, Dick, and Jane off the street that wants to understand what are the issues in education, how can we close the gap, you know, collectively as a community, as a police department, as, you know, a mayor's office, political, churches, things of that nature. It gives them some very applicable things that they could do that's going to help the village raise the children.
Okay, and so your book is called 240 Ways to Close the Achievement Gap.
Right.
And I guess the first question would be, can you describe to the audience what is the achievement gap?
Well, the achievement gap really is about the haves and the have-nots. It's about equitable educational resources, about equitable educational opportunities for low socioeconomic groups and people of color than the affluent neighborhoods like the Edinas, you know, the Eden Prairies, the Wayzatas that have countless amounts of money from their revenue, from their housing, that gives them opportunity to have stuff in their educational system that many places in St. Paul doesn't because of their housing base is a lot lower. So it's about evening the gap from a financial standpoint. It's also about evening the gap just from adhering to certain core standards and state tests that we have in Minnesota.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So it's about solving the difference then between the haves and the have-nots.
Exactly.
And, well, what have you found in your research? What are some of the differences?
Well, a lot of people will talk about, say it's about race. It's not about race. I want to dispel that. Race is a small part, but there's some things within that we really have to focus on is that all our children that are coming into education, early childhood, up to fifth grade, are not being able to read and write and reason at the grade level. So, for instance, if you take a young man who or young lady of Latino or African-American descent in the third grade, they're normally reading at a first grade level. So now when we social promote to fourth grade or to fifth grade, they're still lagging behind. So my question to America and to education is, what's the quality of our intent? If we're gonna social promote a child who can't even function at their grade level, we're setting them up for failure. Mm-hmm. So I say all that to say is, about 15 years ago, I did a study and there was some numbers that were staggering. And I talked to Senator Franken about this and he was kind of flabbergasted. In 1996, there was 3,900 African-American students that started ninth grade.
In Minnesota.
In Minnesota. Mm-hmm. 4 years later, 33% graduated. Now, if you flip that from a race standpoint and say only 33% of Caucasian students in Minnesota graduated, it would be a firestorm. People would get fired, be upheaval in education, and be major reform. But for whatever reason, the African-American community has not came forward strong enough to say, hold a second, we're not teaching our kids appropriately. We're not teaching our Latino kids appropriately. So I really wanted to focus on how we can come together and not point fingers and work in a collaborative atmosphere and say, let's get this ship right. Let's make sure that all children are having a holistic experience in education and that they're getting the things that they need, that the well-to-do affluent neighborhoods are getting, and opportunities, and then make sure that they're graduating at the appropriate levels.
Interesting. So what ignited you to, or motivated you to start to get involved in education and specifically with the achievement gap?
You know, I was the kid, you know, we came in from Chicago and lived on the east side of St. Paul. Mm-hmm. It's a very blue-collar neighborhood. Mm-hmm. Now when you go to St. Paul, it's probably more diverse than, on the east side of St. Paul than other areas, even Frogtown. When I went to St. Paul Harding, I was one of a handful of African-American students. Only reason why I did well is because my parents pushed me to do well academically, to be socially inclined to my community, have friends of all races, and not worry about color, but worry about the humane, how people are treating you and giving you respect. Those were my pushing points for me to get through education, only be one of few. Now, we look at the east side of St. Paul. Harding is 60% Hmong. When I went there, it might have been 1% Hmong.
Wow.
Total diagram, you know, this total shift. Mm-hmm. So it's about getting people to understand the differences, how they build meaningful relationships with other diverse students. How do we get people to understand that just because someone looks different does not mean that they can't learn, and we should have the same high expectations as we do for kids at Creighton Durham Hall or at St. Thomas Academy or in Edina. Mm-hmm. When I was there in Edina working, children in the middle school are talking about going to college already. I would be far-fetched to find that happening in some of the St. Paul urban schools or some of the other urban areas in the Twin Cities.
Hmm. Interesting. So this interest then led you to write your book. And can you talk a little more about the process of deciding that?
The book is something that's inside of you, and you have so much to say, and there's not a lot of outlets for you to be able to get that out in a constructive manner, in a consistent manner. So I decided I start writing, and then I found out, well, you should dictate it first because you can get your thoughts out and get it edited. So I started dictating, and at one point I had over 400 pages. So I had to break this whole project down into four different books. And so what I did is I have just a regular book for anybody off the street, 240 ways. Then I broke it down for teachers only. And then I have a workbook that comes out with teachers that talks about differentiation instruction, a conversational piece for teachers where teachers can take it and glean about what are the things that they're doing right now in their classroom that are best practice, what aren't they doing, and what's their plan to make it happen, to do all the things they need to do in their classroom and make it applicable to diverse students. Hmm. And then I have one for students only, which is a book and a workbook that goes from fifth grade to 12th grade, giving them all 125 books that they need to read before they graduate, giving them all the things they need to do from the writing, the math, all the extracurricular, individualized learning plans so that they can be ready to be successful in college. And then I have one for leadership, which will come out in 2014.
Nice. Well, can you talk about some of the highlights of the 240 ways? What are some of the biggest points that you make in the?
There's so many things, and I'll go with the ten things that school districts can do to close the achievement gap. Mm-hmm. You know, we talk about adopting standards. Mm-hmm. That's very important. We talk about recurrent academic achievement tests that are nationally normed. We talk about that. We talk about improving low test scores, and again, I talk about in here creating plans of improvement and implementing and monitoring those consistently. A lot of times, school districts aren't able to really follow the data, so they have to develop SMART goals so they can change as the data changes and tweak some things for their students so they can learn higher. Biggest thing is literacy. If you can't read, write, and reason, it's going to be pretty hard-fetched that you're going to be able to get into college and do well. And so they need to be able to read. That's major. So early childhood is very important to get our kids in there. Secondly, they need to be able to, you know, do their math. And then also think on a high level. And I think a lot of kids, if they take the urban aspect of how they think and they flip it and turn it into a positive atmosphere, a positive energy, we'll have a lot of wealthy people walking around here. And I tell that to the kids at risk that I work with right now. You know, if you take that energy and twitch it, you'll be great.
Mm. And do you have any experience with alternative forms of education? I mean, we have a public school system here in Minnesota that's mandated by the Minnesota State Constitution. Mm-hmm. We have a thriving private school network, the Catholic schools and other schools that are out there. What about charter schools? What's your experience been with charter schools?
Well, 10 years ago, I was blessed to have the opportunity to open up the first public African-American military academy in Minnesota and also in the Midwest. It was open for about a year. We did a lot of great things. We lost some enrollment. We closed our doors. I take full responsibility for that venture and learned a lot along the way from our students and our parents and our community. The one thing that I would say in my life that hurts the most is that school is not open still, because we made some great positive gains with those students. Doing boot camps in the summer, you know, doing our staff retreat, the different parades that we would do in the summers, and people, when they found out we had 300 kids, and out of that 300, 187 were special ed, but we weren't having any behavior problems, people started to take notice what we were doing. But when you lose revenue in education, and I think the school board member elected, he would agree, you know, when you have 300 kids and the state is paying you a certain amount of money in the beginning, and then you lose 150 kids, well, the state is thinking that you still have those kids, and they're like, oh, wait a minute, we've overpaid you, so they stop your money. And so when that charter school closed, a lot of people didn't understand why it closed. Well, the state had overpaid us because, you know, we were projected and had the 300, and then when we dropped our enrollment, they said, well, we overpaid you, we have to wait to catch up. And so when you're not having those funds coming in and being able to stay viable as a new school, we had to close down. And so for me, it was a learning lesson. Take full responsibility for the school closing, and look to continue to use my expertise in working with schools turnaround in the future.
You know, there's a lot of talk in the Minnesota legislature and even on a federal level about early education, pre-K education. There's some mixed data that shows that there are some initial results, and there's some data that shows that those initial results sometimes are washed away in the first years of elementary school. Right. So can you talk a little more about pre-K education and early education from your experience and whether that's a successful strategy for closing the achievement gap?
It is. From a financial standpoint, for school districts, if they have kids in early education, early childhood education, when they get to the fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth grades, it saves the district about $500 per student. So from a financial standpoint,
how did they calculate that?
I don't know the exact formula, but the thought process and the whole matter is that they're able to say that they're not having to put as many resources into that student because they got them at an earlier age and were able to work with them on some educational things and behavioral things, you know, at an early childhood. And so they equate that over time, less resources for after school programming, and then they do an equation where it saves them money. Now, the guys in the back room with the pointy pencils and the calculators, they figure all that out, but that's what the research is saying. Do I agree with that in some aspects from a financial standpoint? Yes. I think we might even have to go a little bit earlier and do all day pre-K at 3, getting kids motor skills, you know, doing all the things that you do at those early ages. Mm-hmm. Especially for African-American kids and Latino kids. It's just a must, because the one thing from a cultural standpoint, a lot of those kids' parents are working two jobs. Mm-hmm. They're not being taken to the library. They're not getting all those, getting immersed into different situations academically, but the affluent kids are, so they're some steps ahead. But I go back to Bill Cosby, and he was totally right. Michael Eric Dyson tore him down, but Michael Eric Dyson was wrong himself. Bill Cosby said this: if we'll spend $170 for a pair of tennis shoes, $120 for a pair of jeans, but we won't spend $70 for Hooked on Phonics, there's something fundamentally wrong with that thought process. When Hooked on Phonics is proven to help our children be able to read at a level so they can be more successful in education. So I'll spend $170 for a pair of jeans that are going to wear out or I'll outgrow in a year, but I won't pay $70 for my child to learn how to read for a lifetime. Mm-hmm. It's a crazy mindset. And so I think for African Americans and Latinos, we have to look inward and not point the finger, but also take some accountability for what we're doing with our children and our families and our community.
Yeah, and you mentioned something at the beginning of our interview that really stuck to me, and you mentioned your success in education and graduating from high school. You largely attributed that to your parents.
Yes.
And the values that they must have instilled in you and probably motivating you to do your work. And you know, I've taught before, I've talked to a lot of teachers, and that seems to be the number one factor that you hear over and over again that's consistent, is that when the parents are involved, that sometimes can bypass the issues with the lower income and mm-hmm. can bypass the issues with the achievement gap. And so my question is, how, in your opinion, can we get parents to be more involved, to invest into their child's education, to sit down with their child when they're 4, 5, 6 and read books to them and teach them to read? Do you have any ideas on that?
Yeah, I do. And had an opportunity to talk with Jesse Jackson when my fraternity had their national convention here. And one of the things that was important, you know, if you think back in the 80s when we had this big baby boom, when high school kids were having babies, well, we're dealing with the second generation of babies having babies. So if you look at it, when you have a baby, 13, 14, 15, 16, having a newborn, and those kids, the babies watch their parents, materialistic, you know, all, they have the nice clothes, da-da-da, the language, the culture. Well, they think that's the way to be. Well, when you and I came up, our mom and most of our parents were together, married, worked, were upstanding citizens, weren't into the limelight of urban culture. They talked about respecting other adults, respecting our community. You know, your word is your bond, things of that nature. Well, the urban community is not teaching that in this era to their children. So when babies are teaching babies, you're going to get baby behavior, and that's what we're dealing with. So hopefully, if people could stop procreating at a younger age and wait till they're more mature, uh-huh. I think, one, that's going to help. Mm-hmm. Also, we're dealing with a lot of mental health issues. A lot of these babies are coming out that are, you know, hooked on crack and hooked on meth, and there's some mental health issues that in education is big bucks that's costing school districts that we have to work on. Thirdly, the church, I really feel, is one missing component mm-hmm. That is going to help this whole thing go forth. The church has to get back ingrained into the community, especially in the homes. The fourth prong of that, I would say, it takes the village to raise a child. I'll never forget Coach Kimmel, Coach Maurer, Coach Keenan. There were guys that were my coaches, my teachers. Always, hey, knock it off. My neighbors, Art Botel, let him rest in peace, a World One vet, used to always tell me, Donnie, I'm going to call Doris. And he called my mom, and he swapped me across the butt. And then when I go home, you know, I had to deal with my mom, who's a retired Army sergeant. So, you know, it takes a village, mm-hmm. and everyone has to carry their own water. We got to get on board and make it happen. So we just got to have people stop having babies at a young age and have them at a more mature age so that they can be a proper role model for their child.
Yeah, you bring up a good point, too. I coach basketball at St. Mark's in St. Paul.
Okay.
This year I'm coaching fifth graders. I've coached sixth, seventh, eighth graders for the last 4 years. And the one thing that I find, sometimes I'm a little tough on the kids. Mm-hmm. I'll make them run, you know, if they're acting up. But I find that kids want to be disciplined.
Yes.
And in a way, to discipline a young person, especially if it's your son or if it's your student, is really one of the best ways, I believe, that you can show that young boy or girl love.
Mm-hmm.
And too often I see that parents are failing to discipline their child, to teach him to get into routines for right. homework and everything like that. So I think that would be a great, great cultural standard to start setting in the Hispanic community, African-American mm-hmm. community, and the American society in general. So,
right.
But do you want to tell us a little more about how people can get a hold of you if they want to, or how they can purchase your book if they want, or find out more information about the work mm-hmm. that you're doing?
If people want to order the book, I'm doing a pre-sale order right now. I have 1,000 copies to pre-sale, and they can just send me an email at 240ways mm-hmm. at gmail.com. My website will be live by Wednesday, hopefully, and it's 240ways.com. I just want people to know I'm not I'm not claiming to be an expert, but I have done some research and I have worked in education for over 15 years, and I do know that there's some things, all things in this book are applicable to closing the achievement gap, and I just think it's important for us to come together as a community and speak our truths and have a seat at the table and say, okay, what are we going to do together collectively to help our children? Because they're our most priceless commodity. And my thing to the community is, what's the quality of our intent? Are we going to sit and let our kids waste away, or are we going to step in and make a change?
Sounds good. Well, Dallas, you want to put that put his cover up there, 240 Ways to Close the Achievement Gap. Mr. Donnell Tenner, thank you so much for coming in. I hope that people do their research and look into this book and this important issue. I'm glad that we have you working on this, and we have other great people like the school board candidate, David Martinez, who's running in St. Paul. I know that that's a big issue for his campaign, his early campaign, is closing the achievement gap for all students and students of color in St. Paul. So thank you very much for your work that you do, and I appreciate you coming on the show.
Appreciate it. Thank you,
Donnell. Mm-hmm. All right, so beautiful to be back here after missing last week. I tell you, I get really excited every single time thinking about this show. And like I said, I started my new job this week. So things have been especially hectic for me as of lately. And two shows ago, I announced that my Lenten resolution was giving up alcohol, beer, wine, and liquor for Lent, 40 days, 40 nights. So far, so good. But I have to confess that when I was in Atlanta for the training, you know, we had all the new people. It's a national company I'm working for at First Option Mortgage. And there was a couple nights that we went out, and it was an initiation to our company, and everybody was there, and people were drinking beer. And I confess that I had a couple beers each of the nights. And so, I don't know, I come from the Japanese or the Asian tradition. It's when you're doing a business deal, like, and people are having a beer to solidify that business deal, I feel like you kind of have to take part in that ceremony. And I didn't want to stick out and be like, oh, you know, I'm the Catholic who gave up alcohol for Lent and do it that way. So just letting you know, confessing that I'm not perfect. Many of you may have thought so, but sorry to disappoint you. I'm bringing on our next guest, Mayor Mark Corbin of Oak Grove. I'm happy to have him here. We're going to talk about a whole bunch of things. So, Mayor,
well,
thank you for coming on the show. I appreciate it.
Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, your first appearance here. This is our eighth broadcast of the Tony Hernandez Show. So we're still, you know, it's a work in progress. But one thing that's great is we've been able to get a whole wide variety of guests. We've had State Senator Roger Chamberlain on. Representative Joskowski was on last week talking to Jake about the new gun restriction proposals that were on the table. I think most of them are.
Let's hope they're off.
Are going to be off the table. The Minnesota people are speaking. And my personal theory was with the whole thing is the gun restriction was actually smoke and mirrors, distracting us from what they're really doing, and that's implementing the healthcare exchange full speed ahead.
Yeah.
You don't hear any debate about the healthcare exchange or whether Minnesota needs it, what exactly it is. And so I think that a lot of that was distraction. What do you think about that?
I couldn't agree more. It's unfortunate that our elected officials that have the ability to make those decisions to regulate guns or to try to pretend that they can step on the Second Amendment is just amazing to me. I don't understand how our country got where it is by having elected officials in our state currently, and other states too, trying to take away those freedoms. The only thing government does, in my opinion, is basically control and regulate and try to minimize our freedoms that our founding fathers put in place.
Yeah, and it's one of the reasons why our show focuses in on education issues, because although most Americans can read, I believe what we're dealing with in many ways an illiterate society still, where a lot of people just regurgitate what's fed to them either through the politicians or through the mainstream media. And the evidence to that is President Obama's famous line that, or what did he say, if we could save just one life from these gun restriction laws, then it's totally worth it. Well, that logic is just, it doesn't work with me, because I think of something like, for instance, alcohol, and or even just take lower shelf vodka. How many lives, how many families, how many fatalities have occurred from people, abusing alcohol?
Yeah.
So by President Obama's logic, we should get rid of alcohol too. Wouldn't you agree? Is that consistent?
It is consistent. The problem is that you can't have an officer walking behind every person to protect them. This country was based on freedoms. Those freedoms are that I have the right to protect myself, my family, and my property. That means I have the right to hold and carry weapons. And it's not only just to protect myself from other people, crooks, but it's against a tyrannical government also. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's really why the Constitution was there, to say that they can't limit the ability of a government, or they can't have, the government can't regulate the normal or the law-abiding citizen from protecting himself with a weapon.
Yeah. And, you know, a lot of times people will get laughed at if you say that one of the reasons for the Second Amendment is to protect from government, because a lot of people don't really believe that tyranny can exist in modern times, whether it's because there's a belief that the information is so open and we have all these different sources to check things. But really, that is the most dangerous belief that people can have, is that evil doesn't exist.
But it would... with government, you get a there gets a point where the government gets so powerful and so controlling and so regulating that what is the only option? Are we a bunch of sheep that to go through gates that the government tells us to follow in this direction, and we don't have the ability to stop? And if you stop, for example, taxes, you know, I as the mayor have the ability, as long as I get a consensus of council, to tax whatever we need to do, what we say we need to do. We can take as much money as we feel we need to. At what point does the state get to do the same thing? I'm trying to correlate, I guess, when a government has the ability to tax, to control, way above what the majority of people are allowing, that's when I think there comes time that we need to possibly have a revolt. Start out peacefully, but we may need to look at that someday in the near future.
Well, let's talk about some of the things in your own city.
Sure.
First, you want to talk about Oak Grove, the city, is, you know, whether you were born and raised there, and a little more about the demographics and the people that live there.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting, the things that we've accomplished in Oak Grove over the past, this is my first term as mayor. I was a city council member before that.
Okay.
I was a planning commissioner. So, and then before that, I was on the Parks Commission, and I was actively involved in my local community for many, many years before I even decided, you know what, this is something that I feel passionate about. I'm very committed to doing the job as a city council member and representing the majority of the residents if they'll have me represent them and be a vocal person for their represented elected official. So I got involved because there are so many people that I believe are the silent majority, and I wanted to speak for that silent majority. I'm not a fanatic. I'm not a gun-toting, shooting in the air type guy.
A gun nut.
No. And you know what's it's funny, Tony, is I feel embarrassed almost. There are a lot of people that feel like we do, that we have the right, and then but yet we're apologizing for protecting the Second Amendment, for my rights as the Second Amendment. I have to apologize for that? For some reason, there's something wrong with that. In Oak Grove, I started out as a city council member. Mm-hmm. There were two conservatives, me and another city council member, Scott Lawrence, who got elected at the same time. We came on to a board of five, so we were two of five. We tried to bring to the light conservative values, reductions in staffing, reductions in the exorbitant health care that they were getting as employees, but we couldn't get anything done until we had one more city council member come on, And then at that time, I also ran for mayor. So we had a consensus of three, and then we started making changes.
Three out of how many?
Five.
Three out of five.
Oak Grove, just for your viewers, Oak Grove is a northern Anoka County suburb, mm-hmm. Of 8,500 people. Mm-hmm. Bedroom community. It's some farms, a lot of subdivisions, small business, a little bit of industrial. It's kind of a real nice northern Anoka County city. It's no different than any other city in Minnesota, North and South Dakota. You know, it's a typical city. Mm-hmm. We have 8,500 people, roughly 2,800 homes. We're growing, but with this economy, we went from 110 homes a year to three. Wow. New homes a year back in 2009. So what we made changes to the staffing directly related to the amount of building going on, staffing needs. We need a government, but it needs to be in the background. Mm-hmm. And I've said that from day one. I've been doing this long enough now to realize that you have to treat everybody fairly. Mm-hmm. Everybody's entitled to their opinion. But when you try to reason with people, you put rules and regulations, ordinances, and policies and procedures in place so that you treat everybody the same. There's no special treatment for any one group, any one person. And that way, everybody feels that, okay, I understand where you're coming from. Even though I don't agree with you, at least I can appreciate that you're treating me fairly. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So the big thing that we did in our city is, with the downturn in the economy, the first year we cut our taxes 18%, a little over 18%.
So this
in
is
the
a,
first
what,
year.
What kind of tax is this?
It's the levy.
The levy, okay.
The levy, we cut our levy 18% in the first year. Mm-hmm. Last year, we cut our levy an additional 8%. We did that by means of changing staffing, outsourcing where we could, looking at different ways to accomplish things for our residents at a much more cost-effective way. Mm-hmm. For our citizens. Mm-hmm.
So when you say you cut the levy, just for people who aren't politicals, mm-hmm. out there,
sure.
How does that translate to your average resident in Oak Grove? Does it mean they pay less in property taxes? Or
yes, yeah, it directly relates to the amount of property taxes that come, or that come from your pocket, uh-huh. To if whatever county you live in. The in our city, it was in Anoka County. So we cut 26.33% in 2 years. Now, we did that with means of not only cutting the staffing and looking at different expenditures, mm-hmm. and getting more frugal with our expenditures, mm-hmm. but we also looked at what are the reserves that we're sitting on. Those reserves, you know, the rainy day fund, mm-hmm. you might hear that term, oh, yeah. all the time.
It's essentially a surplus, right?
Yeah, it's a surplus of revenue that has been taken out as tax money from the residents and put into this great big pot. Mm-hmm. And we had taken out double-digit levy increases for over 20 years. So that money kept growing and growing and growing and growing. Now, there is a certain amount of levy that's required, or surplus that's required from that levy, and recommended by the state guidelines, accounting guidelines. We're way our city's way above that. So what we decided to do is start taking some of that surplus, which is tax money, mm-hmm. and give it back to the residents in lieu of raising or actually holding the levy at the same amount.
And I'm sure they were very grateful for that. And I'm curious, so for, you know, say your average homeowner in Oak Grove, mm-hmm. what's the average value of a property there, 150 or?
No, it's actually closer to 250.
250?
Yeah.
Wow, so yeah. So the cuts that you made in the taxes equated to how much reduction in the average property of Oak Grove?
Well, that's an interesting point, because the school district has a large portion of it. The county has a large portion. The city's portion is usually the smallest portion of a tax bill or the tax property tax statement. Mm-hmm. So most of the residents saw between 10 and 15% reduction of the city's portion. Mm-hmm. And we didn't cut public works expenditures that keep roads and safety issues. Mm-hmm. So matter of fact, we increased those expenditures.
You know, one of the issues or consequences trumpeted from the sequester, the recent sequester that hit on Friday. You know, I went on CNN.com. The front page was a picture of an adult male with a really long look on his face. You know, he was almost about to cry. He must have been about 45. The caption read, what is he going to do? And he was a federal employee, and you know, it's sad. This guy probably has a family. He probably has kids. He needs to pay his bills, just like all of us and everybody watching has to pay their bills. You know, the less sensitive side of me thought, well, you get another job. I've been like, you know, I've had to change jobs multiple times. But yeah. My question, though, for you is, when you had to make those staff reductions and, you know, people had to lose their jobs, mm-hmm. I mean, can you talk a little more? Did you get backlash from that, or do you feel bad? Or
there are a lot of people that believe that once they're a government employee, they stay there. You do what you have to do to keep those employees employed, even if there's nothing for them to do. Tony, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm the CEO and president of my company that I have in Ramsey, Minnesota. I have 25 people currently. I had as many as 58 employees back in 2001, too. I do product development, design engineering. I've been doing design engineering, electrical and mechanical design engineering products, and I have my own inventions and products that we build and design and sell. It is very, very difficult to go into a room of people and say, I'm sorry, but we are in business to try to make money. If we can't get the type of revenue to support the staff in private sector, we can't afford to pay people to sit there and do nothing. I don't understand why that mentality doesn't go to government also. It's pretty amazing to me how if I go up and talk to people that are working in government, whether it's county, state, the bureaucracy is what is the drain on the tax situation that we currently have. When you go up and talk to those people and you have an honest and open discussion with them, if you say that money is going to come out of your pocket, the money in your department is going to come directly out of your pocket, is there anybody in that department that you feel that you could reorganize and let go so that they can go out and get another job? Look for another career, whatever it is. But most of the people, when they're honest, even the government employees, and I'm not against government employees. We need a good staff, highly skilled employees. But it should be in line with the private sector. Most of those people that I ask that are employed by the government, they typically say, you know what, I know of four people in my department that we could do without because it's either redundant or they're overpaid for what they do. There's different ways to do things. In our city, we had a finance director that was making over $90,000 a year. And in business, you typically look at 30% on top of that for benefits. In government, it's typically 40 to 45% added for benefits. Well, when that person decided to get another job in government, we looked outside. She was working 50 to 60 hours a week. We actually found a way to go outsource for about $50,000 a year. They worked 4 days a month instead of 50 hours a week to get the same jobs done. Now, that person quit. We looked at an alternative, and it worked out great.
Interesting. Well, we're about almost out of time here, mm-hmm. Mayor. I thank you again for coming on. But is there anything else that you'd like to share with the audience while you're here?
Well, I think what really is important is to get involved. Get go to your city council meetings. Tell them that they're either doing it right or they're doing it wrong. We don't hear enough that, yeah, you guys are on the right path. Fortunately, everything that us three city council members out of five have done has actually been on the plan of reductions in spending and reductions that are positive for our city.
Hmm. Very good. Very good advice. Well, thank you again for coming on.
Well, I appreciate
it. And hopefully you'll be able to come on again sometime in the future.
Well, I hope so. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. And we're continuing on, and we have Jake Dusenberg, who's going to be coming on next, and we're going to be talking about a whole variety of different subjects, as we always do, anywhere from the personal items to the economics, and I think we're going to try to talk about some real estate and perhaps some of the current events that are happening out there as well. So Jake, he's sitting right next to me here, and just want to say my appreciation for him coming on every week. And also filling in last week on the show. I think he did a great job. I heard a lot of great feedback from people who are watching this show on a regular basis. As a reminder, we broadcast live every Saturday from 4 o'clock until 5 o'clock. This isn't a Republican show. This isn't a Democrat show. This is a show about local issues that are affecting all of us here in Ramsey County. That's why you see a wide variety of different guests that we bring on, and I really want to hone in on bringing in a balanced viewpoints to get voices heard from a diverse spectrum so that you are getting your value added by tuning in, and also that you have incentive to share this show with your friends, with your family. We put it up on YouTube on MNCD4 Conservatives. Usually gets on every Sunday. You can look us up there and share us on your Facebook, tweet us out there and everything of that. So with no more avail, I'm going to bring on Jake. Jake, good to see you.
Good to
it's
see
been
you
a while.
Does this mean I'm your token conservative to have on the show for your balance?
I don't know about token conservative, but it's great to have you here, though. I think, you and I, although we agree on a lot, I think there are some areas where maybe we're slightly different in our viewpoints. And so I certainly enjoy you coming on and getting the opportunity to see you almost every week. But there's a couple, 1 week a month that 1 weekend a month that you have your National Guard obligations.
Yeah.
And
yeah, for another 3 months only. So
for another 3 months.
And then I'm gone. I'm done with the Army full time. So but yeah, it's nice to come on the show. It's a lot of fun talking about economics and just regular political issues, especially guns. And last week I had a wonderful opportunity to host a show in lieu of your absence. And I didn't tell Dallas and Tim I was going to say this, but most people at home that are watching this show don't realize how hard it is to put together a show like this. So Dallas and Tim do a wonderful job getting everything ready for the show every week, and obviously making Tony look good when he's here and making me look good if I have to fill in. So I just want to let the viewers know that these guys are the ones actually making this thing work.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that. Dallas does so much work behind the scenes. Sometimes I liken him or compare him to the Wizard of Oz, the guy who stands behind the curtains and kind of pulls the cranks and pushes the levers and makes all the bells and the whistles flop up there. So, yeah, I have a lot of appreciation for his hard work. And not only that, does he dedicate his time every week, but then he goes home, compresses the video, puts it up on YouTube, make sure that people are able to see it every single Sunday, because not everybody can tune in to SCC television. You essentially have to be within right. Ramsey County in order to see the show. So
well, and last week we were filming at the Capitol, and about an hour later I think we were going live on this show. Now Dallas alluded to something about editing the film in the vehicle, but I won't go any further than that, because that might be an illegal activity. But it was amazing. He was able to get both segments of that interview ready to go within about, I think, actually less than an hour's time.
It's
so.
Just ran the converter, is all.
It's okay. It's pretty amazing. I do some video work, and I know that just even compressing a video is not easy. And I know they have those laws out there where you can't text and drive, but I actually don't think there's any laws
against... Nothing on video editing?
No. So you can go
there
out.
You go.
This is not advocating video editing and driving, so please do not do that out there. But, pretty amazing. And I was going to call in last week, and we talked, but then after talking to you, I just felt so comfortable with you spearheading the show and taking over with things that, you know, my mind was at ease the entire time. So,
well, wasn't my friend the Colombian Fernando Franco? Wasn't he a fun guy to listen to?
Oh yeah,
to? Wasn't that an interesting interview?
Yeah, and a great topic too.
Yeah, very interesting.
Because you know these inflationary issues are very real, and
right.
If you look back in history, there are multiple accounts of banking and printing of money going out of control. Remember that what happened in Zimbabwe recently, and Argentina in 2001, and Colombia, and well, right before the Hitler really took tyrannical control of Germany, you had the collapse of the Weimar Republic, and there's famous pictures of people literally with a wheelbarrow full of money to buy a half a piece of bread.
That's right.
And you know, with the digital age that we have now. We don't need that cash currency, but you can venture to guess that the digital aspect of banking and the printing of money is really fueling our next hyperinflationary crisis that, you know, we don't know exactly when it's going to take its full effect.
Right.
But
inflation in and of itself, which is increase in the money supply, which I like to talk about quite a bit. Because a lot of people talk about inflation as in just rising of prices. If we focus on the fact that inflation's real definition is increasing the monetary supply, then we understand that there are many different results when you increase the monetary supply. Lower interest rates, for one. Another one is stagnant prices, which I thought you wanted to talk about real estate today, and that's what I would speculate is happening in the real estate market, is that we're actually having maybe leveled off prices when prices actually should be coming down. So, and that's actually the natural tendency for things, is for prices to come down over time, because manufacturers and companies are more efficient at producing goods and services, and therefore it's less cost for them to actually produce that, and therefore the price of that comes down in a competitive environment.
Sure.
So the fact that we have stagnant prices in the economy in and of itself, I think, is a result of the increase in the money supply.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about that a little bit. You know, I started my new job, so this last week was my first full week at First Option Mortgage.
Sure.
It's a crazy market out there. My phone was literally ringing off the hook with people who are looking to take advantage of the low interest rates, to refinance, to take advantage of some of the programs like HARP that are out there that are allowing people to refinance at unlimited loan-to-value ratios. So if your property's worth $100,000 now and you know you have a $200,000 mortgage, there may be a way to lower your interest rate to 3.5% or something like that on a 30-year fixed rate, which I find absolutely amazing. I was in the mortgage business in 2002, 2003, 2004, 2005, which is really was the height of soaring appreciation. And since then, there's been a deflation in real estate values. And there's been some recent news that have shown that from last year till this year in the Twin Cities here, that some areas are seeing around 10 to 11% appreciation. And we're certainly seeing that in appraised values that are coming through. And I guess my question is, in your economic opinion, are we on a real estate recovery, and is this is this going to continue?
Well, when you look at what the Fed has done, they've come in and tried to lower interest rates to actually go down even further than they were back during the boom cycle. Part of quantitative easing 3 is buying mortgage-backed securities, so that takes some of these bad mortgages off the books of other banks and other companies in an effort to keep rates low. So if that's what they're doing, is keeping rates low in order to keep prices stagnant or actually increasing the prices, well then what happens when interest rates go back up? So what I like to relate to my clients and people when I talk about economics is what happens when interest rates go up in the mortgage industry, in the bond industry, and other industries, things that are inversely priced from interest rates. And that's really what mortgages are, or housing prices are inverse to interest rates. I'll give a good example here. You're kind of putting me on the spot. I do have a printout, and I would have brought that in if I would have known about this. But if you look at a typical 30-year fixed rate, a good borrower.
Like a conventional
Conventional loan. Yeah, it's just under 4%, all right? So that's where the 30-year fixed rate is on a, you know, high credit score. If that was to go up 2 percentage points, all right? And a home sale still has to take place, all right? Because people have to move for family, retirement, jobs, whatever it be. So there needs to be a market. The buyer is not going to be able to afford the home at its current rate if interest rates go up 2%. Now, that buyer individually can't make any impact on the interest rate. It's just the environment that he's in. And in this case, I would assume those rates are going to go up very quickly at some point in the near future.
Mm-hmm.
That 2% increase in interest rate on a typical $200,000 home could sink the price of that home about 20% in order to keep those monthly payments for that buyer the same way, at the same level.
Mm-hmm.
Now, why do I bring up monthly payment? Because that's really what it's all about. A lot of people, in fact, most Americans, look at finances on a month-to-month budget forecast. And so when they look at the affordability of a home, they don't look at the price, the sticker price. They're looking at what they can afford, you know, knowing that they have this much income a month and then what their expenses need to be.
Yep.
So let's say their mortgage can not be past $1,100 a month. Well, then if interest rates go up, something they can't affect, then in order to keep those interest or to keep their mortgage payments the stagnant or the same, the housing price has to come down.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I like to talk about is when those interest rates go up, we have a serious problem in the real estate market.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's a couple things that could perhaps save it. And one of the motivators behind the Federal Reserve policy, and Chairman Bernanke mm-hmm. has gone on the record stating that, is they want to fuel with this the bond purchasing and the quantitative easing, what they're trying to do is fuel employment.
Mm-hmm.
And they believe that they won't stop it until unemployment, I think, reaches below a 7.5% or something like that mm-hmm. on a national level. Maybe it was a little lower. But that's one of the theories behind it. And then the other theory is through the quantitative easing, you can actually increase wages as well. Are we seeing that at all?
Well, no, not with wages. In fact, in January, I think it was just reported incomes dropped the lowest they have in like 20 years or something like that since the early
90s. Yeah, I think it was there was a 3% drop in W-2 wages.
Right, and a lot of factors that, you know, go into effect there. December is and that's a month-to-month drop, so December is a high income month for people because of holiday season and holiday spending. And then also you have the 2% payroll tax hike that took effect on January 1st. So some other factors into that. So, but I don't see the income levels rising, certainly not the level that our monetary supply is being increased.
Mm-hmm.
You asked me another question.
Just wages and unemployment, lowering the unemployment
rate. Yeah, so unemployment. Government can't affect that. This is an old Keynesian argument that the government can step in and try to help with employment, and to a certain extent, yes, maybe they can. I think it was Milton Friedman that once talked about his trip down to Panama. I think it was Friedman. Someone might correct me. I hope they don't call in and put me on the spot here. We'll just say a wise man once noted going down to Panama and looking at all these people digging using shovels and bulldozers. And if this was a government work site, if they wanted to double or triple the size of the workforce, why not hand them spoons, right? So, I mean, technically, government can create employment, but not good productive employment, not the way that the free markets can.
Mm-hmm.
No free market company would ever dig a hole with spoons. Mm-hmm. They would use the greatest resource possible, a bulldozer, a scooper, I'm not a construction guy. They would use the best source possible and be the most productive. And that's really what we need to talk about is how do we get that back to the free markets? How can we make them productive? And that's the best thing for jobs going forward.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And, you know, another, going back to the interest rates,
mm-hmm.
I personally don't believe that the mortgage interest rates are going to go up anytime soon. And the reason why that is because mortgage interest rates are tied to the bonds and they're tied to the mm-hmm. Fed funds rate,
right,
which has been set at between 0.0 and 0.25, historical all-time lows, between 0 and 0.25%. And it's been that way, I believe, since December of 2008, right? Ever since President Obama, ironically, took office, the Fed funds rate has been essentially zero.
Yeah, 25 basis points.
And so, we're not going to, in my viewpoint, we're not going to see interest rates rise, because if they do, the result would be that the U.S. government, the federal government, would be unable to pay the interest, and it would cut even further into the deficit. There's a famous statistic right now that out of every dollar that Washington spends, 42% of it is borrowed money. If the rates go up even a fraction, that 42% will become 48% or 50%. If they keep going up, you're going to get pretty close to 100% servicing of the debt, meaning that all the money that we pay towards our taxes to the federal government will go just to pay interest to China and Japan and to the Federal Reserve. And so I don't think that the rates are going to go up anytime soon, but what do you think?
I totally disagree with what you're saying. I don't know when that's going to happen, but the Fed's only functionality right now to keep those rates low is by giving us the perception that there's high amounts of cash or reserves or savings. Because that's really what an interest rate is an interest rate is a price. It's the price to borrow money. So if you think about it, there's a large supply of money.
An endless supply, essentially.
Well, but let's
just
say there is a large supply of real capital, real savings in the economy. Well, then an interest rate should be low, because there's a lot of, you know, a lot of places to get your money from. But if savings is low in an economy, which it really is, real savings and capital investments low in a society, well, then more people have to fight for that money to borrow it for whatever it is, a conventional loan, a mortgage, a business loan. And that actually makes the price of that money more expensive, i.e. the interest rate. So the only way that the Fed can keep those rates low, the price of borrowing money low, is by creating more inflation, in essence creating more savings and capital in this economy. But that doesn't come without a cost. What happens in inflation, as I alluded to before, some other effects. Even if it's not increased the prices on every good and service in the economy, even though I would argue that's what happens in fuel and food, and certainly areas that the government's heavily in, education and healthcare, at least puts upper pressure on prices, and that somewhat stagnates a housing market that prices should be coming down in, or you know, maybe electronics, which tend to have a very deflationary period as we become more efficient producing electronics, they stagnate in price. So either way, that's a bad thing for us. And it certainly hurts the very few savers out there in the economy, because the savers now both lose any chance of getting a decent rate of return on their savings, and then also can't keep up with the rising prices in the economy.
So you're saying when you say that this is going to happen, when do you think the rates are going to go up?
Yeah, well, Dallas, do you have my crystal ball down there? The hardest thing about being an economist is ever predicting when an event's going to occur. And people will sell books trying to do this, but what I've noticed, the smartest economists, those of the Austrian school of philosophy, which really what I've been talking about is the Austrian business cycle. It's something that was made well known by Nobel Prize laureate F.A. Hayek. And none of these guys ever predict the timing that this will occur. But more recently, a very wise man, Peter Schiff, if you've ever heard of him, predicted the housing crash. A lot of guys like Ron Paul, actually in office, predicted the housing crash. And what they did is they talked about what's going to create it, but they didn't talk about the timing of it. And so when it occurs, you know, it's, you know, at a certain period of time, they weren't wrong on the date. They were only shown that they were correct on that the event was going to occur.
Oh, that's so interesting. Yep. Well, we're going to have to continue this conversation next week, Jake.
Sure.
You're going to be here next week?
I don't know. I might have to. We'll have to see.
Well, let's hope so. Thanks for coming on. Thanks, and this is the Tony Hernandez Show. Thank you for tuning in. I'd encourage you to tell your friends, your family about the Tony Hernandez Show every Saturday from 4 o'clock to 5 o'clock. Share us on your Facebook wall. Like it. Do everything. Thank you for tuning in. May God bless you. May God bless America. And vaya con Dios.